when they were giving birth. For example, health professionals avoiding physical contact with them, disclosing their HIV status to other staff, and not feeling like they had been treated with dignity and respect. And for many of these women, they weren't in a position, they didn't feel in a position to make a complaint or to provide a kind of feedback or challenge their treatment. We know that Black African women are 4 times more likely to die in pregnancy than white women, and childbirth than white women. And 12% of maternal deaths are to refugee and asylum seeker women, who only make up 0.5% of the population. Asylum seeker and refugee women are also particularly vulnerable to other mental health issues and physical health conditions, and at risk of dispersal, where they're moved across the country to other locations during pregnancy, sometimes to a number of locations, which can be distressing, and can mean also they're separated from friends and from family, and have experiences of giving birth without a partner or without an interpreter present. The second point which I'd like to make, which is linked to this, is about ensuring we understand why choice is so important, and that without choice that meets the diverse needs of these different groups of women, and particularly some of the most marginalized women, we risk increasing gaps both in outcomes and in well-being, and the gaps between the women that benefit and the women who don't benefit from choice. So for WEC, this means that it is essential that we can hear and we listen to the voices of different women, and that we have a system that's able to hear those voices and respond to them, to address the inequalities women might face as a result of their ethnicity, their HIV status, their age, their class, learning disability, whatever it might be, to be able to empower women to take control of their lives and be able to make decisions so that they feel confident to be able to make those decisions and access the type of care that they're entitled to. Thank you very much.
Now, the reason I say that is that one of the choices that women make is related to whether they would like a cesarean section, and all the numbers go into that. I'm sure Dr. will actually expand on that aspect in due course. But dependent on clinical need, a doctor can actually say, no, we don't think you should have a cesarean section, even though that's one of our choices. What is the law? The law provides guidance for those wanting to know what the law is, and it also provides the court with the means on which the court can determine whether a person has broken the law. Now, the reason I put that in is that the only time
consent is also given to a fundamental. regulating utilities. The outcome of their choice, believe it or not, is irrelevant. So, for example, if they are do not want to have a fair inspection, you are looking after their neighbor. And you, over of your opinion, because you're all professionals and you make all the relevant observations, that this woman should have a cesarean section, and if she doesn't, the baby may die. The outcome is irrelevant. It's hard to accept that, because as midwives, you're in the profession to care for women, to make sure that they're healthy and their babies are healthy, and you're placed in a dilemma. The bottom line is that the individual makes the choices, however inappropriate that choice may seem to the health professional. Clearly, their consent is required for every intervention, even for the stadium, you need to get their consent. Clearly, there are exceptions, and I wouldn't go into the exceptions, but it's related to the Mental Health Act and public health and COVID disease, etc. There is a presumption that every individual has the capacity to make a decision and thereby consent or refuse treatment. So they can do both. Can I consent to having it or refuse treatment? As I said earlier, the key to consent is the healthcare profession must provide information regarding the procedure which are their requested consent and should explain the risks and benefits. And more importantly, ensure that the client understands the facts of the procedure. You have to remember that your profession is regulated, and you've got code of conduct guidelines to follow. Guidelines are only guidelines. If you deviate from the guidelines, you should be able to justify them. There are local policies in place, local guidelines within your trust unit. And that will assist you when it comes to caring for women and supporting them in their choices in labour, pregnancy and labour. As I said, there's a code of practice and it's a good medical practice which you will comply with. And if you deviate from that, you need to justify it. Regarding the act, I spoke of the law of consent. There is the law, you're expecting your physical integrity, which is the law of negligence, duty of care, if you breach that duty, causation, and what remedies are applied if you go through the court. Also, there is privacy and confidentiality, and how that relates to human rights law. Article 8 of human rights is the one that's actually